Hey, this is Sean. What's going on? YouTube recommends I watch this. Some other people recommended. My dad worked on this train. Is my first time watching it, so I have no idea if the audio is any good or if it's narrated. I'll tell a little bit about it. Unless the narrator says everything already. Says the Metro. They had these in Washington, D.C. They also had them in Montreal. There's 300 of these things made. Know, 300 cars. This looks like it's two cars joined together. Or it might be one that flexes in the middle. But my dad worked on this. The brake systems, hydraulic systems, anything hydraulic he was involved in. They didn't want these things, they didn't want passengers falling over the minute the things accelerated or stopped, because people tend to stand in these things if it's crowded. And when these things approach the stations, people get out of their chairs and they start walking to the doors. So when the thing breaks, when the thing slows down, my dad wanted it so that you don't feel the thing decelerating at all. Otherwise, you're falling. You let go of that hand thing in the ceiling, you let go of that, and you go, ah, you go flying. Like a quality of life kind of a thing. And also he designed the door mechanism so that the door would open up, be nice and smooth. What else did you do on these things? Anyway, and then yeah, also the brake system had to work in snow. So both these cities had snow. So if there was any elevated outdoor stuff with these things, the tracks would be covered in snow. So the things had to work 24/7. As a kid, when I was 10, I think these things were being built when I was 10. Over at Rohr Industries in Chula Vista. And I just remember them being torqued and twisted and pulled on and vibrated. They'd have these like giant arms just pulling it and tossing it around, giving it stress tests before they come up with the final design for the frame. You have to have all these safety things and stuff. But when I was a kid, I would watch them do that as a kid in the factories, because this was Rohr's next big deal. And it doesn't matter which is the front or which is the back. This one says it's computerized. So that's something new. I didn't know about that. I figured there'd be somebody piloting the thing as usual. Anyway, so when I was a kid, all I knew about this shape here from the 70s, reminded me of these guys. It's very 70s. Everything had this shape in the 70s. So when I saw these things, I instantly thought of, Huey, Dewey, and Louie. But everyone, 70s, right? Orange, you got orange chairs, orange carpeting, all brown wood paneling everywhere. Yeah. Anyway, so 300 of those cars were sold by Rohr. I think that's all they made. And then over time, Rohr would refurbish the things, or a third party would come along and refurbish them, put new furniture in, new motors, that kind of thing. Update it. Give the horn a better sound, have the computer lady or the computer guy say what the next station was going to be. So this is done back in 1976, huh? By the way, I have tons of, what do they call it, slides? My dad took slides for some reason. He'd go out there with his Canon AE-1 or FE-1 or whatever it was, one of those Canon cameras, and he'd take all the pictures, you know, as work was being done. My dad was too poor to have a Super 8 camera, so he took slides. One day, I'll put the slides on the internet. He took like 300 pictures of this thing. He might be in this video. Who knows?
Here beneath the streets of Washington, they built the world's newest underground railway system. The whole thing's controlled by computers. There are no queues for tickets, no clerks to issue them, or inspectors to punch them. Significantly, you see very few railway men or women.
Okay, so it was like the way it is now. In California, you got these light rail transit systems. Most of them are electric, you know, with the electric cables above and the cars scrape against it to go. There's no one at these stations. That's where you go to die. If you go to a station in California, that's where you go if you want to die. Because someone with a machete is waiting for you. There's no police. There is a person driving, but they're in a bulletproof, you know. They're in a chamber. They're not coming out for nothing if someone's in. Basically, he honks and waits for people to get out of the way so he doesn't run them over. That's about all he can do. Yeah, nowadays, these are all covered over with yellow bumpies for blind people. I don't know if blind people care about that stuff. It's a pain to walk on, that's for sure.
The Washington Metro, a railway of the future built now for the city's commuters. Again, the only humans in evidence are the passengers. It's clean, modern, efficient. The energy, the work, the bulk of the responsibility to provide such a service, it all comes from computers.
The computers don't...
Well, there's still a pilot on board. But for the most part, it's the controls that are all done by computers. Basically, it's... Is the station up ahead open, or should I just race through there and not stop for nothing?
Don't only monitor the fare and ticket collection, but they also control the trains themselves. They're almost fully automatic.
Almost.
The computers regulate the speed, what time they arrive at the station. They apply the brakes and start the train up again. If anything goes wrong, then they'll automatically cut everything off. And there are even computers which monitor those computers.
Electronic machines do most of the work.
Electronic. What's these screens for? It's kind of cool. This is when Colossus takes over and he starts transmitting on all airwaves and signals and stuff and TV channels that he's taken over the Earth.
It was possible to persuade the unions to accept such low staffing levels because this was a purpose-built railway, completed only a few years ago. There was nothing here before.
Call me back when that fire alarm.
Hello.
Station. Exit's on G Street.
See, there's the pilot. He's got his microphone. You still have to keep an eye out for bums that go into the rails.
What, the night?
Now, it would be possible for passengers like me to be the only human beings involved. But as you've just heard, there is one person on board the...
He sits corrected. Yay.
...train, because they've deliberately built in a human factor.
People like to know that there's people with people. So we have a computerized system to the edge of the state of the art. But then we always have a human being that you can contact. In the mezzanine, there is always a person that you can ask for directions. Or if one of the machines...
He's behind glass. Only what you see, pal. Keep moving. Where do I buy my ticket from? He probably sits there 8 hours a day and points at this thing. Use this to buy your ticket. Now, I remember the old Santee, or not Santee, what was it called? Santa Fe, the old Santa Fe Railroad. It might still be there, that station. And you'd have to wait in line, talk to a real person, buy tickets for your train. Now it's all done on phone, I think.
If it goes down or goes bad, then he can make minor repairs. In the head of the train announcements are made with a real live human being.
It's just like an ATM or lotto machine. Same thing.
Though we're capable of making it computerized.
What's the real significance of using new technology on this? Is it a pointer to what everything's going to be like? In the
it
future?
Makes it safer. It makes it more even of operation. It makes it cheaper than hiring hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people whose salaries go up continually through the ages, whereas the machinery doesn't. But it gives a wider horizon, wider...
Yeah, the price of electricity shoots up, and then the price of tickets shoots up. That's usually how this goes.
...mobility to the people themselves.
Computers made it possible for Washington to afford its new railway. That's because the cost of running it will remain stable. People are the most inflationary feature of any business. Their wages only move in one direction, up. Once you've paid for a machine or a computer, that's it. So while London's tube travelers will always pay ever-increasing fares, the costs in Washington will be less influenced by staff wage bills.
These guys. Let's tax these people that are buying tickets.
It's the benefit of having fewer people at work.
Wonder where they digged up this old fossil. I have some old videos like this, but it's for monorails, you know, what do they call it? High speed, rapid transit, blah, 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 hovercraft, anti-gravity monorail stuff. You know, I need to start transferring those from DVD or whatever onto the YouTubes. Metro 77. It's like an RPG. Kind of reminds me of the maps they have in Fallout 3 for their subways. What is with the flag? Okay, they must have passed out flags. I didn't get a flag. That was neat. What's this one? Computer history. Oh, have I done this one yet? I think I've done this one. Yeah, all the chicks in these mainframe videos are skinny. There's no fat, ugly chicks in these things. Yeah, that was neat.